It was around 10 o'clock in the morning, and I'd just taken a bus up the top of a mountain to reach a rural village in Kenya located about 2 hours south of the city of Nairobi. And when I say I took a bus, I really mean it was a 5-person SUV that I squeezed into with 10 other people who, like me, needed a ride up. It was definitely a little cramped, but for $2, I wasn't complaining. My destination at the top was a community church where a group of 30 or so avocado farmers were gathered and waiting for me and my two co-founders to arrive. We were there to introduce ourselves and our company, Vunatech, in the hopes that they would be willing to work with us. I was 20 years old at the time. It was my first time meeting rural farmers, and the first thing that struck me was how old they all were. Not in a judgmental way, but I was curious why nobody there looked even remotely close to my age. Some of the farmers sat with grandchildren on their laps, and in that sea of faces, I saw many deep lines etched by years of hard work on the land. I'll back up for a moment, because by now you're probably wondering how I, a fourth-generation Canadian mechanical engineering student, ended up here. I didn't grow up on a farm, and neither did my parents, who were both police officers. As a kid, I dreamt of becoming an astrophysicist and never imagined myself working on anything related to agriculture. That all changed in my second year of university when I first learned about the Green Revolution of the 1960s. At the dawn of the 60s, our world was on the brink of disaster. The population was growing rapidly, and catastrophic famines across mainly India and Asia were projected to take the lives of hundreds of millions through the 70s and 80s. Thankfully, these grim predictions never came to pass, due in large part to breakthroughs in selective breeding attributed to an American biologist named Norman Borlaug. Many of you have likely never heard his name, but he's been credited with saving over 1 billion lives from starvation thanks to his work developing new wheat and rice varieties that increased the calorie intake of the average Asian by 160% between the 60s and 90s, even as their population more than doubled in that same time frame. As amazing as the Green Revolution was for the world, one thing became glaringly obvious and unsettling to me. The Green Revolution completely missed the entire continent of Africa. If you look at yield output from the early 1960s to today, you'll see that yields have steadily increased in every region of the world except Africa, where for 2 generations now, yields have remained stagnant and have even decreased in some areas. Why this has happened is too complicated to explain in sufficient depth today. But part of it has to do with how quickly food grains, especially rice, flooded world markets in light of the Green Revolution. This brought rapidly falling food prices, which eventually made importing food to Africa cheaper than growing it domestically. In addition, at the time of the Green Revolution, many African countries had only recently gained independence from colonialism and were struggling in the aftermath. Many regions were left with a lot of unclaimed land and a lack of well-defined rules for land tenure, resulting in multiple overlapping claims, which complicated investments into agricultural productivity. Early independent countries post-colonialism were also left fiscally undeveloped, with understaffed and undereducated bureaucracies. It's not that they lacked the intention to support farmers, it's that they lacked the capacity to make economic policies with reliable statistical information, and were plagued by a host of other pressing issues as the Green Revolution unfolded. As a result, policies that might have led to long-term yield improvements, like infrastructure development and fertilizer subsidies, were not effectively implemented soon enough. This prevented much of sub-Saharan Africa from ever reaching food self-sufficiency, the results of which have been grave and far-reaching. Today, Africa is a net importer of food. The continent contains 25% of the world's arable land, yet only produces 10% of global food output, even as 70% of its population makes a living from agriculture. As an engineer, I've always been fascinated by cutting-edge technology like artificial intelligence and robotics, and I'm amazed by what it has enabled our species to achieve. But as important as it is for us to continue pushing forward the margins of what humanity can accomplish, it's equally as important that we ensure no one gets left behind. It sickens me that for two generations now, virtually nothing has changed about how farming is done across such a vast and densely populated region of the world. But what's even more troubling is that in many ways, history is now repeating itself. By 2050, our world will reach a global population of 10 billion people. After world hunger consistently declining each year since the early 2000s, it began to rise again in 2019 and has been on the rise since. Organizations like the UN and the Rockefeller Foundation predict that this trend will continue if urgent action is not taken, especially as climate change creates environmental conditions that are increasingly hostile to farming. The world is in a very similar position to the one it was in the 60s, and we will need another green revolution to avoid a catastrophe. After learning about the first green revolution and how Africa was left behind, I became convinced that the next green revolution will need to involve unlocking the vast potential of Africa to become food self-sufficient. I had no idea how this could be achieved, but I knew it was possible since all of the tools and resources needed to raise yields already exist. And it's been done everywhere else in the world. By a stroke of luck, I met my co-founders online 3 years ago, and together we started the project that eventually became our company, Vunatech, named after the Swahili word vuna, which means harvest. Both of my co-founders are Kenyan and were raised on smallholder farms, which are farms less than 5 acres in size, typically located in rural areas. Despite making up the vast majority of the farmers across sub-Saharan Africa and collectively feeding 70% of the continent's population, smallholder farmers receive the fewest resources and endure the greatest hardships. They typically rely on traveling brokers to buy their produce, but these brokers come to the farms inconsistently and hardly pay enough for the farmers to break even. Larger, more legitimate buyers hesitate to work with smallholders due to their rural locations, limited production volumes, and difficulty in meeting formal market quality standards. We surveyed over 600 smallholder farmers in Kenya and found that due to these challenges, they are often unable to sell their produce in time. And an average of 41% of what they grow ends up going to waste before it can ever be eaten. And this is in a country where over a third of the population is undernourished. We are working to prevent this loss and ensure farmers earn a fair income by helping them form collectives and providing shared resources like access to group training, agro inputs, and group loans. With this support, farmers are able to meet the quality and quantity requirements of legitimate buyers. We then connect them to these buyers and organize group transport from rural areas to ensure timely delivery of their produce. A few years ago, I knew absolutely nothing about agriculture. My experience on farming was limited to yearly trips to the pumpkin patch for Halloween. But after spending 2 years working on Vunatech remotely while attending university in Kingston, Ontario, I knew it was something that I wanted to commit to in a meaningful way. I needed to be on the ground. And that's how I found myself in a rural village at the top of a mountain in Kenya, standing in a community church, face to face with smallholder farmers for the very first time. After introducing ourselves, my co-founders and I explained to the farmers what we were trying to achieve with Vunatech, and they were interested in working with us. But by the end of that meeting, there was still one thing on my mind that I couldn't shake. I decided to speak with some of the farmers one-on-one, and with translation help from one of my co-founders, I asked them all the same question. Where are the young people? And from each farmer, I heard the same answer. They've left for the cities in search of work. As I traveled to other villages throughout my time in Kenya, meeting more farmers along the way, this absence of young people became impossible for me to ignore, and every time I asked about them, I heard the same story. After growing up watching their parents struggle to make a living as farmers, most had lost any aspiration of taking up farming for themselves and see migration, either overseas or to urban areas, as their only option. And this isn't just limited to the farmers that I've spoken with in Kenya. This is a trend across the entire world. If young people are abandoning farming, how will we ever sustain a population of 10 billion people by 2050? Economic growth from agriculture in sub-Saharan Africa is 11 times more effective at reducing extreme poverty than any other sector. A successful agricultural foundation is the foundation for any flourishing society, and most African countries haven't yet built that base. But I know that if youth are empowered with the right resources and education, they can collectively create a thriving agricultural system that doesn't waste massive amounts of domestic resources while heavily depending on imports. The few times that I did meet youth when I visited the villages in Kenya, they were always so eager to learn and so motivated by the opportunity just to earn a decent living when we showed them it was possible through farming. Plus, youth have access to mobile devices and are digitally literate, which their parents and grandparents never were. There's so much potential, but it's crucial that we show youth how farming can be worthwhile so they don't feel forced to search for other opportunities. Farming is far from easy, but it doesn't have to be unprofitable, especially in a region where food is so desperately needed. But this change needs to happen now. We don't have another few generations to spark the next green revolution. We only have one. In the year 2050, I'll be 47. There's a chance I'll have kids around the age I am right now. So it's up to my generation to prevent a food crisis that could be even worse than the one we narrowly avoided in the 1960s. And this next green revolution will need to involve the entire world, not just Africa. When I returned to Canada following my first visit to Kenya, something about the way I viewed food had shifted. For most of my life, food was like this infinite resource that magically reappeared on grocery store shelves on repeat. I'm very fortunate to have grown up in a country with a strong agricultural foundation, but our food system is far from perfect. You might think that in North America, with all of our modern technology and resources, there would be significantly less food going to waste than there is on small-scale farms in Kenya. Well, unfortunately, that's not the case. The UN estimates that 30 to 40% of the food available for human consumption in North America is lost or wasted, which mirrors the average of 41% amongst the farmers I work with in Kenya. When you can't see where it comes from and understand everything that went into producing it, food becomes so easily replaceable. But when you can see and touch your livelihood as it grows in the soil, the thought of wasting it becomes painful, almost a betrayal of the effort it took to grow it. Research suggests that if high-income countries reduce their post-harvest waste by half, we could spare up to 63 million people from undernourishment. I believe that significantly reducing our food waste will be one of the most difficult, yet critical pieces of achieving a global green revolution by 2050. Yet I also believe it begins with something as simple as repairing our relationship with the food we eat. A little bit of exposure to farming may seem inconsequential, but for me, it was life-changing. And it made me wonder why I grew up never learning anything about it. I was learning about astrophysics at 14 years old, but couldn't have told you the first thing about how my dinner had made its way onto my plate. There's something very backwards about that. Food isn't infinitely replaceable. It's a fragile and finite resource that deserves more than a thoughtless toss in the trash. So I challenge you, especially if you're young, regardless of what you study or do for work, try growing something small, or visiting a local farm, if only to reclaim a sense of connection to and appreciation for the food you eat every single day. Because we can't build a world without hunger unless we can first build a world where everyone deeply respects their food and the people who grow it. Thank you.